From the world of politics to the world of business, this is Balance of Power. Live from Washington, D.C.
From Bloomberg's Washington, D.C. studios to our TV and radio audiences worldwide, welcome to Balance of Power. Alongside Kaylee Lyons, I'm Joe Matthew.
President Biden announces the U.S. will begin airdropping humanitarian aid into Gaza as he faces growing pressure to step up support for Palestinians with a ceasefire agreement still out of reach.
The federal judge in Florida indicating the classified documents trial will likely be postponed from its current May 20th start date. We'll speak with former Watergate prosecutor Nick Akerman.
And Fed officials push back against the idea of rate cuts coming soon, even as consumer confidence deteriorates. Mark Zandi of Moody's will be with us. Joe, happy Friday. It has been another incredibly long week here in Washington. And of course, the economic data continues to come, something that will very likely factor into this election cycle. It already is. But there's a lot more to discuss, including geopolitics in that regard.
That's true. And it's all going to come together this weekend at Camp David, where President Biden is going to be spending a couple of days to punch up his State of the Union address set for next week. Of course, there will be many elements to the address, from the economy to, as Kaylee mentioned, geopolitics, with having had hope for a ceasefire in Israel evaporate over the past couple of days. Scores of Palestinians killed and injured during an outbreak of violence in which Israeli troops opened fire near a convoy of trucks attempting to deliver humanitarian aid in northern Gaza. The president weighed in earlier during a meeting with the Italian prime minister today at the White House.
The loss of life is heartbreaking. People are so desperate that innocent people got caught in a terrible war, unable to feed their families, and you saw the response when they tried to get aid in. And we need to do more, and the United States will do more. In the coming days, we're going to join with our friends in Jordan and others in providing airdrops.
Joining us now, Bloomberg's Nick Wadhams and Megan Scully to walk us through our top stories. Nick, let's begin with you. It's good to have you with us back at the table. News of the U.S. Doing aid relief airdrops over Gaza, making us wonder why we have to do this when an ally is on the other side.
I mean, this is the extraordinary tension and why today was such an incredible moment. The president basically saying he's going to do an end run around Israel and drop aid. Obviously, the scale of the aid that can be provided through airdrops is nowhere near what they would be able to do. Their hope had been to send hundreds of trucks into Gaza every day, and obviously that's not happening. You had this violence. But I think the bigger issue here is what you're seeing is a president much more willing to turn his back on Prime Minister Netanyahu and say, listen, okay, you guys are not going to get this done. Mm-hmm. We're just going to do it ourselves and let the consequences be damned. So very much interested to see how this plays out, what the Israeli response will be. Should also say there are a lot of questions about what these airdrops will actually look like, whether the U.S. will use military assets or will work through its partners, the president there suggested. So lots of questions.
And it's almost remarkable to believe that this was only the beginning of this week. But on Monday, when the president was in New York and getting ice cream with Seth Meyers, he suggested there could be a ceasefire agreement in exchange for the release of hostages still being held by Hamas as soon as this coming Monday.
Right.
Seems like he's walked back that expectation a bit. How close are we, if at all, to a deal like that?
Well, that comment really caught a lot of attention because everybody was like, well, we know there are these conversations happening, but next Monday is really right around the corner, and it feels like there really are some big differences here. I mean, the big one for Hamas, obviously, is, well, if you release these hostages, then does that basically give Israel the green light to intensify its military campaign even more? And then for the Israeli side, well, if you allow a ceasefire, does that give Hamas time to regroup? So those are some of the questions that we just didn't have answers to. So that when President Biden said, hey, Monday, it was like, well, still seems like there's a lot to work on there. He has backtracked significantly from that, though. He says he is still hopeful, but certainly not imminent at this stage.
So you wonder if maybe there's time by Thursday when he addresses a joint session of Congress and the nation, whether we're talking about Israel or Ukraine, for that matter. We were joined earlier today by retired Lieutenant General Ben Hodges, former commanding general of U.S. Army Europe, earlier about military aid or lack thereof for Ukraine. Here's what he said.
The fact that the United States is failing to deliver ammunition is a terrible reflection, not just on the Congress, though, but also on the administration. You know, everything starts with the objective.
Yeah.
What's the purpose? And the administration has not explained why this is so important to America that Ukraine is successful.
So how important is it for Joe Biden, or is it even capable, is he capable of delivering that message on what an exit plan might look like?
You know, that is a great question. He has not really articulated that, but what we are seeing and what the administration is really starting to say is to paint this in really existential terms. You are seeing Russia slowly taking more land, more evidence that Ukraine has really had to ration and ratchet down the amount of ammunition that it's expending, particularly artillery shells. And we are seeing the administration, you talk about end runs, maybe thinking of doing something else where it gets other countries to provide munitions or even sends munitions to Ukraine without having a process in place to replace them. So we are starting to get rumblings that the administration is looking for workarounds here, and that's something that maybe President Biden could point to, because right now it does look like, yes, there's frustration, as Ben Hodges said, there is frustration with Congress, but the administration has put a lot of its credibility on its ability to deliver aid to Ukraine, and right now it's just not able to get it done.
All right, Bloomberg's Nick Wadhams, thank you so much. Now, also today, President Biden signed into law the Stopgap Funding Agreement, averting a partial U.S. government shutdown that could have begun at midnight tonight. Let's turn now to Bloomberg's Megan Scully, who leads our Congress team here in Washington. So there will be no shutdown this weekend, Megan. That does not rule out potentially a partial shutdown next weekend, as we've just kicked the can to a week from today, March 8th. How hard is next week going to be for Congress?
Well, it's going to be a busy week. We also have State of the Union next
week
and Super Tuesday, as you mentioned at this top. We expect to see some legislative language on these agencies that will be that would shut down come March 8th if there is not a deal in place. We expect to see that Sunday night, and then the clock will start trying to get it through the House and get it through the Senate. They're going to need to get started almost immediately into the week in order to abide by the various chambers procedures and rules and kick it through. And they're going to need to do it on the backs in the House of Democrats, because there's going to be a lot of resistance among Republicans there who aren't happy with the contours of the bill, who have said, without seeing it quite yet, and we haven't seen it yet, but they said there's not enough conservative policy wins in there.
So is it possible for Mike Johnson to get this done before Joe Biden delivers the State of the Union, to take that talking point potentially away from him? And if he does, will he get booed by his own conference?
Probably not at State of the Union, but he's already getting, you know, hearing some agitation from the right. But the sense that we are getting is that there is some level of exhaustion, that members are tired of this, you know, back and forth on the spending for the fiscal year that began 6 months ago.
Yeah, okay.
And pretty soon we're going to have a request for the next fiscal year. So it's time to put this to bed. That doesn't mean, though, that there won't be a lot of grumbling, and there likely will be. And reminder, this bill that would fund the agencies starting March 8th, it only covers 27% of federal spending. So the vast majority of the government, the Defense Department, which is about half of all discretionary spending, that would be funded in a bill that would come later in the month. And Ukraine, as we talked about in the last section, that is not included at all in any of this legislation.
Well, and of course, Ukraine is an issue that one senator in particular is very passionate about, Senator Mitch McConnell, who, of course, announced this week that he will no longer serve as the Republican leader in that chamber after the election in November. Has he made himself a lame duck in February, 9 months roughly before he actually is going to step down as leader? I mean, what is he going to be able to do? What leverage does he have going forward?
Well, he certainly has gotten some criticism of that from members of his party who criticize him regardless, like Senator Josh Hawley. But it's not really that unusual for members to signal this early. Senator Harry Reid did as much just a few years ago. But what this early decision and announcement did, and he didn't say this in his speech, but essentially what it did was it allowed McConnell to not be obligated to endorse former President Trump
for the presidency. Senate leadership has.
Like we saw with all of the, with the three Johns and the Steve, who we think will vie to replace
the
him.
Steve.
That would be Steve Daines.
We thank you, the Megan, with us here on a Friday evening. Thanks as well. to Nick Wadhams. Coming up, fresh U.S. consumer sentiment numbers out for the month of February. We're going to break down the data with Mark Zandi, the chief economist at Moody's, is up next on Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio.
Consumers have just stayed in the game. They continue to spend. They continue to want to participate in the economy. And that's spurred growth, ongoing growth. And that's kept inflation a little bit higher for longer than we would have thought. But I still think overall the news is good.
San Francisco Fed President Mary Daly speaking with Bloomberg's David Westin about U.S. consumers and the state of the economy. This is a fresh round of data today shows consumer sentiment faltered in late February as views deteriorated and gas prices went up, marking a reversal from earlier in the month. Joining us now is Mark Zandi, chief economist over at Moody's Analytics. Mark, always good to see you. As we just heard Mary Daly there talking about the resilience of the consumer in an economy that has remained strong, inflation a bit stickier as a result. It brings me to what we heard from Torsten Slok, the chief economist over at Apollo, who made news today with his view that a reaccelerating economy and a rise in underlying inflation means the Federal Reserve will not cut rates at all this year. What say you?
Oh, I missed that. I didn't hear Torsten made that change. I think, you know, it's a scenario. It's possible. But I think more likely inflation will continue to come in, get back to the Federal Reserve's target all in by late this year. Economy will continue to moderate sufficiently that the Fed will cut interest rates. So I expect, you know, if not at the May meeting, it feels like the June meeting, and maybe 0.25 point cut each quarter going forward. So a couple rate cuts this year. I think that's probably more likely than certainly them raising interest rates this year.
You've been pointing to seasonal factors in the PCE data this week. I wonder, Mark, your thought on the first drop in consumer sentiment in 4 months and how we should read into that. We look at it more closely than some political polls around here.
Yeah, no, you know what, Joe, not much. I think that's the University of Michigan survey you're referring to. I don't pay a lot of attention to the particular survey. Yeah, I think it's just people answer the questions there through the prism of their own political kind of perspective. You can, you know, if you look at the responses to that survey by Republicans and compare that to Democrats, night and day, and that switches depending on who's in the Oval Office. So I really don't pay much attention to that survey. The Conference Board survey, I like that survey. That's a monthly survey. They've been doing that since the 70s. And that's more consistent with the consumers doing their thing, as Mary Daly was talking about. You know, if it's an index and the average over time is about 100, I think the last read for last month was 106. So, you know, it's not great. People aren't feeling fantastic, but they're feeling good enough to keep on spending. So, I think by that measure, and I think that's the better measure, we're fine. The economy's doing just fine.
Doing just fine here in Washington, I guess you could say we're doing just fine because the government isn't going to shut down, at least partially, this weekend, as we maybe thought just a few days ago. I know that the economic ramifications of a government shutdown aren't as severe as, say, defaulting on our debt had we not raised the debt ceiling last year. But Fitch actually just released their latest rating of the United States, confirming them a AA+, affirming them rather. And there's a note in here about how divided government complicates the budget process, talking about how it has led to repeated episodes of political brinkmanship surrounding the debt limit, threats of a government shutdown. How, even if not in the immediate term in terms of economic ramifications, how should we be thinking about the dysfunction here in Washington and what it means for our longer term economic outlook for fiscal sustainability?
Yeah, it's clearly an issue, a problem. I mean, our fiscal outlook is pretty dark if we don't make changes to fiscal policy, to tax and spending policy. I mean, just take a look at the Congressional Budget Office's recent forecast. The CBO is the nonpartisan group that does the budgeting for the country. And under current policy, the nation's debt to GDP ratio will go from 100% today. By the way, that's more than double what it was before the financial crisis. So 100% today, I'm making the numbers up, but roughly orders of magnitude, 115% 10 years from now, 180% 30 years from now. I think that's when the forecast ends, but you can do your own forecast. That's not sustainable. So lawmakers do need to get it together and come together. And, you know, when they're shutting the government down or threatening to do that, or, you know, we're going to have to address the debt limit again on the other side of the election this time next year. If they engage in brinkmanship, or goodness, if they actually breach the debt limit, then we got a big problem. So, you know, I think that's not the here and now. That's not the biggest problem we have or issue, but that is definitely a problem that we're going to have to face in the not too distant future, because it is a corrosive on the economy.
Yeah. Speaking to the strength of the consumer today, Mark, Zandi, we caught up with Jared Bernstein, chairs the Council of Economic Advisors, of course, at the White House, who was reflecting on not only consumer sentiment, but other indicators that he's putting together as a composite. Here's what he said.
I don't think anyone should change their view that consumer sentiment, consumer confidence has been moving in a pretty reliable way, in a direction suggesting that economic improvements have been reaching people in a way that they weren't a few months ago. And those improvements, of course, reflect easing inflationary pressures, a strong job market, rising real wage growth, very strong consumer spending and GDP.
You both had a similar reaction to the consumer sentiment data out today, Mark. You mentioned the confidence numbers. What else are you looking at in the next couple of months to gauge the strength of the consumer and therefore get a sense of the direction of interest rates?
Well, you know, the key here, Joe, is that wage growth has to continue to be stronger than the rate of inflation. People's so-called real wages have to continue to rise. Now, that's fortunately been the case now for the better part of the past year. And I think that's one of the key reasons why sentiment, while soft, is steadily improving. People are feeling better about things. They're not feeling great because they still remember back 2-3 years ago when inflation was raging stronger than wage growth. Real wages were declining, and that was undermining their purchasing power. But here we are today. We're moving in the right direction, and all the trend lines look pretty good. I mean, the job market's strong, 3.7% unemployment, rock solid. We've been there for 2 years. That's full employment, and that should support continued solid wage growth. And I, Joe, believe that inflation will continue to moderate. It's headed in the right direction, and I think that will continue, and that means real wages will remain positive, continue to increase. That is the key reason for optimism about the American consumer. There's other reasons, obviously, but that's the key reason. And if you're optimistic about the American consumer, then more likely than not, you're going to be, like I am, more optimistic about the U.S. economy, because the consumer drives the train, and even the global economy. I mean, we're the strongest. The U.S. is one of the strongest economies on the planet, and we're driving growth throughout the rest of the world. And the rest of the world is struggling, but it would likely be in recession if not for the support provided by the American consumer buying lots of what the rest of the world is producing. So, you know, that's the key here, is making sure that real wages can remain positive.
Well, and the resilience of the consumer thus far sure has surprised many. It's a question of the longevity, though, of that phenomenon. Where do you expect we will be November of 2024 when voters are heading to the polls? If policy stays perhaps tighter than we all thought just a few months ago by that point, how much will we have deteriorated?
You know, Kaylee, I think we'll be fine. I think it should be a reasonably good year, maybe not quite as good as 2023, but I think it'll be a good year. And I do, as I said earlier, expect the Fed to start cutting interest rates. But even if they don't, you know, I was only counting on one interest rate decline before the election in November. So I don't know that that's a really big deal. But everything else feels pretty good. Again, the 3.7% unemployment rate, real wage growth is positive. People are a lot wealthier. I mean, stock prices, as you know, are record highs. Housing values are record highs. You know, if you own your own home, 2/3 of the Americans do. You're sitting pretty on all that equity. If you're a shareholder, which is, you know, 60% of Americans, you know, you're doing a lot better. So I think we should be feeling pretty good. I'll throw out one wild card, the thing that makes me nervous, two things. One, oil prices and gas, the cost of a gallon of regular unleaded, and mortgage rates. Those are the two things that I worry about the most in terms of what it might mean for the election.
Mark, it's good to see you. Thanks for joining. Mark Zandi at Moody's Analytics with us today on Bloomberg. Coming up, Donald Trump staring down a big loss if he's forced to sell properties. On that story coming up on Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. I'm Joe Matthew in Washington alongside Kaylee Lines. A brutal commercial real estate market means Donald Trump may be forcing some big losses if forced to sell properties to post a massive bond while he appeals New York's civil verdict against him. Bloomberg's Eric Larson is following this story and brings us a little bit more here. Eric, it's good to see you. We know that Donald Trump is bleeding cash. We've been reporting on that for weeks now as he diverts political donations to pay for his attorneys. What kind of properties are we talking about here? I'm guessing it's not Trump Tower.
Well, actually, you know, it honestly could be, although he has plenty to choose from. We do know that in a pretty remarkable document that Trump's lawyers filed on Wednesday in the appeals court here in New York, just pretty much begging the court to let him get away with not posting an appeal bond for the full amounts of what he owes the New York Attorney General in this civil fraud trial that he lost, $450+ million, and to post the judgment, an appeal bond for a judgment, to put it on hold, you have to post 110 or 120% of the judgment. So that's, he's going to have to do that just later this month if he wants to continue this appeal. And he put a list of properties that he might have to put up as collateral, at least, including Trump Tower and 40 Wall Street, several of his properties. He's saying he could at least put up as collateral. But if it comes down to having to sell them, his lawyer said in his document that he faces the prospect of steep losses that he wouldn't be able to recover even if he were to win the case ultimately on appeal.
Yeah, where the commercial real estate issues we've long been talking about here at Bloomberg actually factor very much into this legal and political case. Just quickly, Eric, what happens if he can't do this by March 25th, the deadline?
That is such a good question, because essentially, if he does not post a bond for 110, 120% or more of this amount by March 25th, the New York Attorney General could begin an enforcement action and essentially try to seize properties to cover this judgment that she is owed as a result of winning this 11-week trial. So there's no reason to believe that it will get there yet. We still have some time. Trump is going to argue to the appeals court put the judgment on hold during his appeal. So there's always a chance that that could happen, or they could allow him to post a smaller bond. He proposed doing one for $100 million. He said he was prepared to do that, but that would be unusual.
All right, Bloomberg's Eric Larson, looking forward to your continued reporting on this. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, coming up, speaking of the former president's legal troubles, we'll talk about them with Nick Akerman, former U.S. Assistant Attorney and Watergate prosecutor, next. This is Bloomberg.
It is an interesting coincidence that they have delayed this for 2 months, and they make it almost impossible to resolve all of his indictments before the date of the upcoming election.
Senator Dick Durbin, the majority whip, speaking with us yesterday around this time. Joining us now, Nick Akerman, the former U.S. assistant attorney and former Watergate prosecutor, on a week that has been full of headlines regarding Donald Trump's legal future, the biggest of which, Nick, came from the Supreme Court this week, and we want to talk to you about that because some think, again, that Jack Smith's trials will never get underway, or certainly his trial in D.C. before the election. But we have news today on the classified documents case. Is everything here going to be delayed other than that trial in New York, the hush money payments trial, until after the election?
Well, we don't really know. It all depends when the Supreme Court comes out with its opinion. The arguments are set for third week in April. They could come out with a decision quickly, or it could take time. We have no idea. Jack Smith today in Florida asked that the documents case be scheduled for July. It was originally scheduled for May of this year, but I think all the parties recognized that they still need more time to get this ready for trial. And so Jack Smith has asked for July. Trump has asked for August, or actually his ultimate request is to have this put over until after the election. But he does have a fallback request, which is in August. So I think the judge is going to come out with a decision in the next couple of days. I think the best thing to get all of this moving forward is to have a July date on the classified documents. The trial in New York, which is starting on March 25th, will certainly be completed in probably 4 weeks. And so you go from that into the classified documents next, and then presumably the election interference case. But it really all depends on when the Supreme Court issues its opinion. Right.
Well, and it's, as you say, that the New York case that begins March 25th could be wrapped within 4 weeks. It would be pretty remarkable to consider that the Supreme Court could be hearing arguments about the immunity challenge here in Washington, and Trump could theoretically already be a convicted felon by that point, should they find in Alvin Bragg's favor in that case. Just thinking, though, about the Supreme Court before then, it's worth noting it was weeks ago that the court heard arguments in the 14th Amendment case, Colorado Supreme Court kicking Trump off the ballot on grounds of the insurrection clause, essentially, in the United States Constitution. Colorado's primary is on Tuesday. Why have we not heard from the court on that issue yet?
Good question. I think we all got the impression from the oral argument that the Supreme Court, one way or another, was going to evade having to make any kind of real decision on the 14th Amendment that would take Donald Trump off the ballot. I don't think that was the right decision, but it's obvious that's what they're going to do. So I don't think they feel like they're under the same pressure, although they should. They should have felt more pressure with the immunity case, because basically they've given Donald Trump, without any real justification, the ability to essentially delay the trial in D.C., which it could have gone ahead immediately after the case in New York. So it's really the Supreme Court's got these cases in its, you know, has the cases, but it's up to them as to when they're going to actually issue their opinions.
Nick, you made your bones in Watergate. What did you think when you saw the headline here from the Supreme Court this week?
I was actually pretty disgusted and disappointed. There is no good legal justification as to why they just didn't defer to the D.C. Circuit. The D.C. Circuit, in a 57-page, well-reasoned opinion, basically said all there is to say about immunity. Now, keep in mind, in Watergate, nobody, nohow, ever even mentioned the idea that we couldn't indict Richard Nixon because he had presidential immunity. I must have had three or four cases that I was investigating Richard Nixon, and nobody ever came to me and said, gee, you really shouldn't be doing that because he's got presidential immunity. The only reason that Richard Nixon was pardoned by Gerald Ford was because of the concern that he would be indicted.
Well, Nick, is it possible that the D.C. appeals ruling was specific to Trump in the case Jack Smith brought here in Washington, and the court decided to take this case to rule more broadly on the question of presidential immunity so that it never has to be revisited again for any president, not just for Donald Trump?
Well, that's not what the Supreme Court normally does. They do not look at trying to have a broad view of the law on this. This is really limited to very specific facts. The D.C. Circuit limited it to those facts, and the Supreme Court should have just let that stand. Because ultimately, after Donald Trump is convicted on that case, they're going to have another opportunity to address the immunity issue on a real record with real evidence. Don't forget, right now, the way this case stands is it's just an indictment. These are allegations. And what the D.C. Circuit decided was that based on these allegations, there was no presidential immunity. Supreme Court should have waited to make their pronouncement on this.
Should have waited, and makes us wonder to what extent they will act expeditiously in the decision that they're going to make here. Nick Akerman, what are the chances that we have a trial that's either underway when people vote or begins in that interim following the election when we have a president-elect?
It's all very possible. We just don't know. There was no reason for the Supreme Court. They delayed even getting a decision out on what they were going to do in terms of granting the appeal to Trump on the immunity issue. They put it over a number of weeks to April, all of which is really outrageous. They could have done this much quicker. So we don't know. I mean, everything is in flux. We don't know what the Florida court is going to do with the dates of either July or August. And those come right in the center of the Democratic and Republican conventions. I mean, we're right in the midst of all of what's going on with our election this year. And you're right, this could all happen just before the election, during the election, or right after the election.
I guess it depends to what extent the delay tactics of the former president's legal team prove successful. Nick Akerman, former U.S. assistant attorney, former Watergate prosecutor, thank you so much, as always, for joining us this evening. Now, coming up, President Biden today signed the Stopgap government funding bill into law, so there will be no shutdown this weekend. We'll discuss the drama either way, though, with our political panel and dive into what to expect next. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. President Biden signed the stopgap funding bill into law today, averting a partial government shutdown that could have begun after midnight tonight. Joining us now, our political panel, Rick Davis, partner at Stonecourt Capital, and Jeannie Shanzano, political science professor at Iona University. As we reflect on the fourth almost shutdown we have seen this fiscal year, Jeannie, are we confident that we won't be talking potentially about a fifth almost shutdown come Friday? Have we seen the last stopgap measure?
I am not confident of that, Kaylee, I have to tell you. It's like, you know, I'm just thinking while you're saying this about all the metaphors, you know, kicking the can. I mean, there's so many. So we bought some time. Guess that's a good thing because nobody wants a shutdown. But, you know, I'm not sure what has changed in the meantime. You know, I mean, literally, when you look at this plan, it's a, you know, mini omnibus bill. I mean, we're going to have two of those, and I'm not sure how that changes the calculation for Mike Johnson. But I think to his credit, he realized that he had to get this done, and he was able to do this. So we'll have to see what happens next.
Well, what's the score here, Rick? They've been moving the goalpost so often, it's kind of hard to tell where we are. There are multiple dates people are juggling now. And as we walk into next week with the State of the Union, are we in a better place than we were before this deal was struck?
We have more information than we were before this deal was struck. I got to remind everybody, this was all supposed to be done by September 30th.
There you go.
Last year. and we've agreed upon a budget number a long time ago. There's never any debate about like how much
about
we were going to spend. We were just debating what we were going to spend it on. And so now I call it the half bus. Six of these bills are supposed to be done next week. Six are supposed to be done the next week. Half bus makes a full bus. And a full bus
just don't call it an omnibus.
So I think it's really kind of simple. I've been working with my 2-year-old on this, and you know, even she's starting to figure out why haven't they done it since September. Sounds easy.
Well,
and so, yeah, I think it's going to get done.
It's pretty remarkable. The second deadline, March 22nd, which is where defense, the bigger bulk of spending, would expire, will be 8 days shy of us being halfway through this fiscal year that this budget was supposed to address. And in the interim, President Biden is going to put forward his budget for the next fiscal year, Rick. Are we even going to be able to start working on that by September 30th?
Well, that's part of the entertainment. I mean, everybody in the Senate is talking about getting to work on these new appropriations bills for this year before they even have passed the appropriations bills for last year. And so, yeah, look, it's dysfunction of government. We all know about it. It's not good. Frankly, I want to get all this stuff done. I'm hopeful that it gets done so we can get on to Ukraine funding, which is what is really time sensitive right now. Frankly, I would have put Ukraine funding ahead of this because these guys can kick the can, as Jeannie would say, forever and, you know, go right into next year's budget. But it does sound like it's on a glide path. It looks like there's some movement around Ukraine funding for the middle of March to start a potential signature campaign for a discharge petition. Mm-hmm. And so, like, we could have a situation where we get all this stuff done in the early March and then get the Ukraine stuff done in the middle of, you know, April, and we're good to go.
Wow. I love this. Rick just figured out the whole thing for us, Jeannie. If we follow this half-bus scenario here, you get your full bus. Does that pave the road for something else to happen, like Ukraine, or is that the last thing these guys are going to be able to figure out this year?
Yeah, you know, listening to Rick, it all sounds so easy, but somebody is going to have to tell the leadership in the House how to do this. So they need to have Rick over there.
Need to call Rick. Yeah.
They have to call Rick and tell him how to get this done. Could this all happen? Absolutely. But I think we have to take a step back a minute and just remember is that, you know, we are now functioning in a government which cannot do the most basic things that it is supposed to do. It's like a mayor not cleaning the sidewalks or not shoveling the sidewalks after it snows. You've got to pass a budget on time. And so this is why when we look at polls that people are so frustrated. And, you know, this gives an opening to Joe Biden when he goes into Congress next week for the State of the Union to talk about this do-nothing Congress, because the reality is they are not fighting in terms of this budget over anything policy-wise. They are fighting, I'm not sure, over what. And so this is what he's going to be able to do when he goes there next week, is say, you can't trust these people with your government because they can't even pass a budget on time.
Well, and with all this news around funding questions around Ukraine, it's worth noting that there was other stuff happening on Capitol Hill this week that we didn't even really talk about. Hunter Biden showed up for closed-door testimony in the impeachment inquiry, Jeannie. They released the transcript yesterday. I haven't seen anything that suggests they found a smoking gun. When are they going to call it quits on this?
Yeah, the impeachment of Joe Biden is, you know, dying. And I read some of the transcript. You know, there was a really fascinating exchange between Hunter Biden and Matt Gaetz, with Matt Gaetz questioning him and Hunter Biden saying, look, I'm an addict and I was an addict and I'm in recovery. He explained all of these things that they raised. And he said, you know, you shouldn't be using this and my illness to attack my father for political reasons. And I think it really, when you read that part of the transcript, speaks volumes. And I'm not sure how they could proceed on this. And in fact, at one point, his attorney said, people are laughing about this. And there's truth to that, because people listening were.
Will that mark an end to this episode? We've already got this guy Smirnoff, who was apparently caught in a lie. That was being held up as evidence somehow against Joe Biden. If the Hunter Biden testimony flopped, we don't have the documents from Smirnoff, where are we?
Yeah, I think you'll see this just go into a low burn. Comer's not going to give it up, the committee chairman. It's like trying to save face. There's not much face left at this point. It's kind of like the Mayorkas impeachment.
Right.
You know, it's gone now. We don't even care what happened, right? It's not going to get a show in the Senate. All these things will start to recede from our view, because everything on Capitol Hill is going to recede from our view. Yeah. We've got maybe another 30 or 45 days left, and then it's all elections all the time. They will not want to be in Washington. They'll want to be in their districts.
Yeah.
The entire House of Representatives has to work for re-election, right? And so these guys are all worried about a very dicey political environment. They got to go home to work it. And so don't expect anything to happen after April.
Coming up next week, jam-packed with Super Tuesday and the State of the Union before they all head home. We'll dive into what to expect next with Rick and Jeannie. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. Thanks for coming along on this Friday. I'm Joe Matthew in Washington alongside Kaylee Lyons. Some billionaire Republican donors are backing away from funding Nikki Haley after Donald Trump's overwhelming victory in South Carolina. But Haley's campaign says not so fast. She's raised $12 million among her various committees in the last month. As we play it now to the panel, Rick Davis, partner at Stone Court Capital, alongside Jeannie Shanzano, political science professor at Iona University. Rick, everyone's asking the same question repeatedly on this program. When's she dropping out? Why would you drop out if you just got $12 million more dollars? What does that tell us?
Well, she's going to spend a lot of that in Super Tuesday. You know, you've got over 20 states that are going to vote on one day. And just the airfare to fly in between all of them, you know, between now and then is pretty expensive. Yep. So, you know, it's not like she's going to have a huge cache of money and can't figure out what to spend it on. I think the broader question is, what is her strategy? Is it just to collect delegates and hang around the hoop and see what happens? Is it to force Trump into something that not totally clear to us what that would be, a debate, mm-hmm. a confrontation? She's definitely stepped up the rhetoric against Trump this week, yeah. right? The things that we thought she needed to do to get a face-off like that, she's doing. So my guess is it's kind of a flip of a coin as to whether, you know, we wake up Wednesday and she still has a campaign or not.
Hmm. Well, she's still pulling in dollars. And, Jeannie, she's still pulling in endorsements. She actually just got her first endorsement from a U.S. senator. Lisa Murkowski of Alaska endorsed her today, saying she was proud to do so as Haley has the right values, vigor, and judgment to serve as our next president. Is that too little, too late? What's an endorsement worth her now when she's lost the first several contests to Donald Trump by a wide margin?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the reality is that, you know, unless something happens to Donald Trump, he is the presumptive nominee. He will wrap this thing up, maybe not on Super Tuesday, but by mid, late March, he's going to wrap this thing up and get the delegates he needs. You know, I think the thing to watch on Super Tuesday, from my perspective on the Republican side, is these closed primary states. Do we see this sort of anti-Trump vote that we think we may have seen in some of these earlier states where people from other parties and non-affiliated and independents could vote? Because, you know, Nikki Haley talking about 40%, a lot of that has stirred ideas that there is a real anti-Trump contingent out there. I'm not sure that that is the case, and I think these closed primary states are going to tell us that it is not nearly as high as we think, and that, in fact, if he's the nominee, which we suspect he will be, most of those Republicans will go home in the end.
You're both going to be with us on Super Tuesday evening and night. We'll have special coverage here on Bloomberg two nights later. You'll be with us again for the State of the Union, which is, of course, an important night here in Washington. And I wonder, Jeannie, the message that Joe Biden is going to be preparing this weekend at Camp David, remembering what happened last year, which turned into Live at the Improv almost, and he managed to use that room of hecklers to his benefit. Does he do it again?
You know, he's hoping he does. He did an outstanding job last time. He has usually, when expectations for Joe Biden are low, he overperforms. I think the critical thing here is he's got to understand, as he does, that the audience for this is going to be the biggest he has. It's the biggest opportunity he has to tell Americans what he has done, where we were when he came into office, and more importantly, what he's going to do going forward. You know, he hasn't been that successful in doing that on the stump. So it's going to be critical. And I think the two things to watch out for domestically are the economy, obviously, and then, of course, immigration and how he takes on this do-nothing Congress and reminds people of the danger of this presumptive nominee, Donald Trump.
Well, Joe has reminded us that the president will be spending the weekend at Camp David, try to put the finishing touches on this thing. If you were helping him write that speech, Rick, what would you suggest he emphasizes to the greatest degree?
You know, he's got to make a case for why another 4 years. You know, everything we've heard is about what's happening in the last 2 years, not what's supposed to happen in the next 4 years. He has not made a case to the American public about how he's going to solve the border crisis, what he's going to do about all these global problems, how he's going to be able to sustain the economy. What is your plan for the future? He's stuck in the past, and you kind of expect that with a geriatric president, but he's got to leapfrog over that, and he has to talk about tangible things he's going to do. It's just not good enough anymore to get up there and talk about concepts, especially on the border. He has to show action. He has to announce something that he's going to do that'll take immediate effect.
So no coincidence they reached for the youngest senator they could find for the Republican response. Katie Britt, what's her message?
Oh, her message is going to be, we're everything that he's not, right? And so it's the easiest job in town. Usually it gets flubbed, but that's a different problem. But the reality is the opposition has always got an easier task. Yeah. We're not them, right? So, you know, failure on the border, that's not us. Failure in the economy, that's not us. You know, we're going to talk about cultural problems that the Democrats represent. The liberals in Congress want to, you know, sort of undermine the cultural integrity of our nation. They're going to use the opportunity to set the broad frameworks for the campaign. This is the last night for Biden where he's actually president. After this, traditionally, it flexes over to now your candidate.
All right, Rick Davis and Jeannie Shanzano, great to have you both this evening and looking forward to spending a lot of quality time with you next week, because it's going to be a long one. And of course, you can continue to get updated on all the busy things happening every week in the Washington Edition newsletter on the terminal and online.
Our political junkies unite. We're going to have a big one next week. Be with us on Balance of Power on Monday on Bloomberg TV and radio.